Good afternoon. My name is Lonnie Stonich. I'm the executive director of the Family Action Network, FAN. We're a 501c3 operating on Chicago's North Shore and doing daytime downtown programming here in this room, as a matter of fact. So thank you. This is our second event here. I want to thank the FAN board and school liaisons, and also then to Loyola University of Chicago's Center for Public Interest Law, its Civitas Child Law Center, and its Center for Urban Research and Learning. Also thanks to the Seminary Co-op Bookstore, who first brought this program to me probably 3 or 4 months ago, and to the University of Chicago Urban Network. A very special thanks, of course, to Miranda Johnson. Where are you? Are you in here, Miranda? There you are. Hi, Miranda. A special thanks to her. She is the Associate Director of Education of the Loyola's Education Law and Policy Institute. And to Michael Kaufman, our dear friend, also FAN board member, the incoming dean of Loyola's Law School. So thank you to him. I think he'll be popping in and out soon. You were handed as you walked in, or was actually at your table already, FAN calls them broadsheets. Inside the broadsheet is a survey. We'd like to collect those surveys from you at the end. If you're interested in signing up for our listserv, we don't ask, we don't charge admission to our events or hit people up for $20 or anything like that. So you should join the listserv. Inside the broadsheet is a list of our remaining programs, actually that have been announced anyway, through the end of May. We have 3 more likely to be tucked in before the end of May that I think you might find of interest. So please feel free to join the listserv. Matthew Desmond, a quick announcement, will also be speaking this evening. So if you're very impressed with what you hear today, contact your friends. He will be at the Seminary Co-op Bookstore in Hyde Park beginning at 6 p.m. for that event tonight. The other thing I want to tell you, just because it's for us right after spring break, 3 programs in a row, April 5th, 6th, and 7th. April 5th, Adam Grant from Wharton at Penn, author of Give and Take and the new book Originals. Krista Tippett will come and do 2 events for us the next day on April 6th. The first one will be in this room at 12 noon, but that requires an RSVP to attend. She'll also speak then in the evening up at Neutra High School. And then the day after that on April 7th, so it's Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. On April 7th, it's Brian Stevenson, the founder and executive director of the Equal Justice Initiative. He will be speaking at 2 events, one at 4:15 at Evanston Township High School, and the other one in the evening at Neutra High School, the East Campus. The 2 programs, as I mentioned, that will be in this room for the remainder of the year will be Krista Tippett, as I said before, and then Angela Lee Duckworth will also be speaking here on her first book called Grit that will be on May 11th, also in this room, also requiring an RSVP. It's my pleasure to introduce to you now Mary Bird, the Director of Public Service Programs and the Street Law Coordinator for Loyola Law School, who will be doing the introduction of Matthew. Mary, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Lonnie. All of you are the beneficiaries of my 30-year marriage. Whenever I ask my husband, when I'm really excited about introducing somebody, what should I say, he responds, very little. They're not there to hear you. So I'm going to be brief. There are a few thank yous and recognitions, though, that I want to make. And first, I assume that you're all here because you've already voted or you're going to go and vote immediately after this program. And Mr. Desmond's book is out front. Take credit cards, $30. If you don't get one today, you can always go down to Hyde Park and get one this evening. There's many advocates here who work on behalf of low-income people on a daily basis and concentrate particularly on housing. And I'm going to try to recognize you, and if I don't get you in this list, please raise your hand and let me know who you are. We have, first of all, Loyola's Health Justice Project and those students who do work in housing, and you can wave wherever these folks are. Okay, thank you. And LAF, I saw them come in right over here. Shriver Poverty Law Center, I think, is over there. Chicago Coalition for the Homeless, there you are. I saw Ellen, I think, come in from Uptown People's Law Center. Excellent. Metropolitan Tenants Organization got here early and passed out their flyers, so you know them probably. Chicago Volunteer Legal Services, I think some folks were coming from there. Thank you. Lawyers Committee for Better Housing, back over there. And I'm not sure if Cabrini Green, were they able to come today? I don't know if they came. Anybody else who's here? Okay, excellent. Thank you. Sorry about that. Anybody else? Heartland Alliance, excellent. I also wanted to recognize our own Hank Rose, who's been involved in bringing Matthew Desmond here, and who for over 30 years has made tenants and their rights, particularly low-income tenants, an important issue to all Loyola students who take his classes. So thank you, Hank. Despite my husband's admonitions, I'm going to say a few words about Mr. Desmond. And if I get confused, I already warned him Desmond is my son's first name, so I might start just calling him Desmond, and he might wonder why I'm calling him by his last name. But anyway, he's an urban sociologist, received two bachelor's degrees from Arizona State University, and his master's and PhD from University of Wisconsin in Madison. At Harvard, he's a John Loeb Associate Professor of Social Sciences, and he's co-director of the Justice and Poverty Project. In 2015, he was selected as a MacArthur Fellow for his work. Mr. Desmond's here today to share his research regarding the impact of eviction on poor families, as well as the role our housing policies have in sustaining poverty and racial inequities in large American cities. In reading Mr. Desmond's book, Evicted, Poverty and Profit in the American City, I initially thought it made most sense for me to try to get two essential elements that I could say all students, since we are a university, must walk away with. But I came away thinking, of course, students should read the book and find their own nuggets of both information and, more importantly, truth and humanity. And moreover, the methods and insight that Mr. Desmond brings to his work and to his writing are relevant to all of us, not just to students. He's learned what he has because he literally immersed himself into the lives of the poor by living in a trailer park, by living in Milwaukee's inner city. And during college, lest you think that you have to wait till you graduate to do some of these things, he started hanging out with homeless folks in Tempe, Arizona. Additionally, Mr. Desmond embraces the reality, as stated in his title, that poverty is not just something that the poor have done to themselves, but it's related to the power of others and the profit that others make at the expense of the poor. Mr. Desmond urges all of us to consider the exploitation of people living in poverty. As he states, emphasizing the importance of exploitation does not mean simply focusing on the greedy or the heartless landlord. Exploitation also means uncovering the ironies and insufficiencies that arise when policymakers try to help the poor without addressing the root causes of poverty. It means trying to understand both the landlord's and the tenant's acceptance of extreme inequalities and our own acceptance of those inequalities. Welcome, Mr. Matthew Desmond.
Thank you.
Hey everyone. So my dad was a preacher. And, you know, I know there's like a thing about sitting in front of the church. I know. But there are these seats and they're not reserved. They're like here for you. You can come and sit in the front if you like. If you gotta leave early, that's okay. I'm just raising awareness about seatage. Thank you, Miranda and Lonnie and Mary. Thank you all for coming and taking time out of your super busy days to come and talk about this crucial issue. Thank you to my friends at the MacArthur Foundation that are here and took me to lunch before. Where are you guys at? Hey, the MacArthur Foundation has been with this project from the beginning. They took a risk on me. It was out when I was a grad student and funded the early beginnings of the survey and then funded it again so we can do it in a real way. And so thank you guys so much, not only for this, but also for all the work you do in preserving affordable housing in this city and funding research that really gets to the heart of how housing is deeply implicated in inequality. Thank you. Okay, so America is unmatched by any developed rich democracy for the depth and extent of its poverty. It's much worse here than it is in any rich democracy. So that fact has always troubled me and bothered me, and I've always found that unnecessary. And I wanted to kind of get my head around that. I wanted to get my head around that in a way that put me in contact with folks that are trying to hard to make ends meet. And I wanted to know like what housing has to do with this problem. And so I started off in Milwaukee trying to understand what it's like to be a family getting evicted and what it's like to be a landlord doing the evicting. So I started off by moving into a trailer park on the far south side of the city. It was nicknamed the Shame of the South Side by the news media because it had so many code violations and police calls. And I rented a trailer there for about 5 months. And then I moved into a rooming house on the north side of the city and rented a room in the traditional inner city of Milwaukee, and I lived there for about 10 months. And from those two neighborhoods, I met families going through an eviction, and I followed them wherever they went. I went to eviction court with them and followed them into shelters and abandoned homes. One family went to Iowa, another went to Texas. I followed them there. And I just tried to get my life as deeply as I could into their everyday lives too. So I watched their kids, I slept in their homes, I ate from their tables, I went to funerals with them and even a birth. And at the same time, like I mentioned, like I knew that if I really wanted to understand this thing, I needed to understand not just the tenant's perspective, but what it's like to be a landlord operating in some of the poorest neighborhoods in the city. So if I was seeing you go through an eviction, I wanted to get just as close with the person evicting you as I did with you. So I went to housing court with the landlords too, and I watched them collect rents and pass out eviction notices, saw them buy and sell properties, saw them screen tenants. And when I was going along with this work, I was kind of confronted with basic questions about eviction and housing, like how often does eviction happen? Where does it happen? Who does it happen to? What are the long-term consequences of it? And I went looking for studies and data that would allow me to get at those questions. Like, this is poverty in cities and community. I thought, like, we would know answers to these questions, but we didn't. There was basically no study, no really good data that would allow us to kind of get our hands around how big this problem is and how consequential its effects. So I did a few things to kind of get at this. I started this survey. We ended up talking to over 1,000 renters in Milwaukee. We called it the Milwaukee Area Renter Study, or MARS for short, because you gotta like brand yourself if you're gonna do a survey. And so we talked to folks from all over the city, some of the best neighborhoods and some of the worst neighborhoods. We put interviewers in these neighborhoods and they talked to folks in their homes. One interviewer was mugged, another was bit by a dog. That was the same guy, I think, actually. He needs to work on a situational awareness. But we worked really hard at getting this data that the MacArthur Foundation funded, and we got an 84% response rate, which means it's really high quality data. And we used that to kind of tell a new story about the prevalence of eviction and the consequences of eviction in a major American city. And I was learning things when I was on the ground that deeply informed how we asked questions differently, especially when it comes to eviction. So a lot of folks that I met, they don't think they got evicted, even though they clearly did. So my neighbors Tim and Rose in the trailer park, Tim hurt his back at work, landlord forced them out through the courts, their names appear on the eviction records, but they don't see it that way. So when I asked Rose, you know, have you been evicted? She's like, no, when you say an eviction, I think of the sheriff's coming and throwing you out and changing your locks. And Eagle Movers, that's like the biggest moving company in Milwaukee that does eviction. Eagle Movers tosses your stuff on the curb. That's an eviction. We weren't evicted. So if we were just like a survey operation and we went to Rose and Tim and said, have you been evicted? Like we do in our national data, they would have said no. We learned to ask the question differently, and I think that speaks to the value of putting in some time on the ground before going after the big statistics. I didn't stop there. We also analyzed hundreds of thousands of eviction court records in the city of Milwaukee, which allows us to tell where these things happen and how frequently they happen through the courts. We talked to over 250 people right after eviction court. I analyzed thousands and even millions of 911 calls in the city and nuisance ordinances and all this kind of other data and put that in conversation with what I was seeing on the ground every day living in these neighborhoods. And I think those different methods reinforced each other, they challenged one another, and each kept the other honest. So Evicted follows 8 families. Some are white, some are black, some have kids, some don't, swept up in the process of eviction. So we meet my neighbor in the trailer park, Lorraine, who was his grandmother, who was paying over 70% of her income on rent, who had to decide, do I pay rent for my trailer or do I pay gas so I can get my heat back on? We meet people like Vanetta, who is like this amazing mom of 3 who like organizes Easter egg hunt in a homeless shelter so her kids could have some fun in this really dark time. Her hours got cut at Country Buffet, and she was so terrified of getting evicted that this woman, who had no criminal record, committed an armed robbery to try to keep her kids in the home. We meet Lamar, who's this gregarious, funny, single dad of two. He's wheelchair bound. He's like the guy, he's like the house like all the kids go to after school. He's like that person in the neighborhood. And he falls behind and tries to work his way out of debt by doing things for the landlord, and it doesn't work out for him. Eviction chronicles these stories, and it chronicles the stories of the landlords too. And today I'm gonna focus on just one story though, Arlene's story. So it had been a really bad year ever since this snowball. Jory, Arlene's 14-year-old kid, had been cutting up, like throwing snowballs at passing cars, and he packed this really tight snowball and he hit this car, and this man jumped out. And Jory and his cousin like ran inside and they locked the door, and the man followed him and he kicked in the door, And he left, thank God, before anything else happened. But when Arlene's landlord found out about that, she evicted Arlene and her two sons for damaging property, and Arlene cussed at Jory because she couldn't cuss the landlord. So Arlene took her boys. Jafaris was the youngest. He was 6, and then Jory was 14. They took him to the Salvation Army homeless shelter, which everyone just calls the Lodge, so you can tell your kids, we're staying at the Lodge tonight, like it's a hotel. And from there, she was on the hunt for another house, and she found one on 19th Street. And there was often no water, and Jory had to bucket out what was in the toilet. It was 5:25, Arlene remembered, for a whole house. It was quiet. It was my favorite place. We know from the survey data that evicted families move from not great housing situations to very substandard housing situations. If we want to know why some low-income families live in substandard housing, which is terrible for kids' health, one of the reasons is they're forced to accept this kind of conditions in the harried aftermath of an eviction. So the city eventually found Arlene's favorite place, this is it, unfit for human habitation. And men boarded up the windows and the doors, and the family was once again on the hunt for another place to live. And she told Jory, Arlene did, we take whatever we can get. And that's what neighborhood and housing selection looks like at the very bottom, just like taking whatever you could get. And what Arlene could get was this drab apartment complex on Atkinson Avenue. But she soon learned it was like a haven for drug dealers. In fact, the whole block was really drug-soaked. And she feared for her boys, especially Jory, who had this beautiful smile and was goofy and would talk to anyone and was eager to prove himself, just like he did with that snowball. So, like, why Arlene moved was really important for understanding why she ended up in such a bad neighborhood. And we tested that with the survey data, too, and we found that evicted families move from poor neighborhoods to even poorer neighborhoods, to high-crime neighborhoods, to even more dangerous neighborhoods. It causes them to experience a downward move. So Arlene moved out as fast as she could from Atkinson. She found this two-bedroom apartment on 13th and Keefe. There was a fist-sized hole in the living room window. The front door had to be locked with this like ugly wooden plank that you slid into brackets. The carpet was filthy and grounded to the floor. But Arlene put on a good face. She stuffed a piece of cloth into the hole in the window, and she hung ivory curtains. The rent was $550 a month, utilities not included, which was the going rate for a two-bedroom apartment in one of the worst neighborhoods in the fourth poorest city in the country. That rent took 88% of Arlene's welfare check. And she knew that some months she'd have to sell her food stamps to make rent, the refrigerator and the pantry would be empty by the end of the month, but her and her kids would try to get by on oodles and noodles. There'd be no extra money for, like, anything. No clothes for Jory or books, no toys for Jafaris. So Jafaris had this habit of going into the basement and just, like, finding stuff, like a dog leash or a mop handle, and turning those things into, like, soldiers locked in battle. Arlene is not alone, as this room knows, in spending the vast majority of her income on housing. For almost a century, there's been a broad consensus in the United States that we should spend no more than 30% of our income on housing. That gives us enough breathing room to buy food and transportation and start a little savings. And until recently, most renting families have met that goal, but times have changed. The percentage of poor renting families, that blue line, the percentage of poor renting families spending 30% of their income on lesser housing has steadily declined over the years. There's seats right here. There's seats here for you. Everyone, give it up. Yes. You're doing it. We're proud of you. We're proud of you. It's not too late. The percentage of poor renting families meeting that goal, spending 30% of their income or less, has steadily declined over the years. But the percentage of poor renting families spending at least half of their income on housing has steadily climbed to the point that today, the majority of poor renting families spend at least half of their income on housing, and one in four poor renting families spends over 70% of their income just on rent and utilities. Just think about that, like 70%, poof, beginning of the month, poof, 70% of your income is gone if you want a roof over your head and hot water. And under those conditions, you don't need like a shock or a major misstep to invite eviction, like something as small as a snowball can do it. For people like Arlene, eviction is much more of an inevitability than it is a result of irresponsibility. So what's happened? What's happened? Over the last 10 years, housing costs all around the country have soared. Between now and 1995, the median rent in this country has increased by over 70%. It's happened on the coast, it's happened in the south, it's happened in the Midwest, it's happened everywhere. Utility costs have soared too. Since 2000, the cost of fuels and utilities have increased by over 53%, thanks to the increase in global demand and the expiration of price caps. But during the time where poor families are seeing their housing costs grow, they were also seeing their incomes flatline or even fall. So these two lines at the bottom are just median income, household income, for families headed by someone with a high school education or even less than a high school education. Their incomes have been flat over the years. So we see like this growing housing cost alongside just flat incomes at the bottom of the distribution. And during these years where more and more families were in need of housing assistance, fewer and fewer were receiving it. Today, only two-thirds of poor renters today receive zero help in terms of housing assistance, nothing. About 15% of them live in public housing, 17% benefit in some other way from the government, like they receive a housing voucher, but the vast majority, the remaining 67%, receive zero. And if you look at the broader national picture, only about one in four families that qualify for any kind of housing assistance receive it. And I think that many Americans today, not in this room, but out there, still believe that the typical low-income family lives in public housing or benefits in some other way from government assistance, but the opposite is true. And just think about that. Imagine if the vast majority of families who applied for food stamps were turned away hungry, if three in four families that applied for unemployment insurance were said, sorry, we can't help you, but that's exactly the way we treat most poor renting families seeking shelter. Arlene gave up looking for housing assistance like a long time ago, but one day, like just on a whim, like what the hell, she went to the housing authority and she asked about the list. And the woman behind the glass told her, the list is frozen, because on it were 3,500 families who had applied for rent assistance 4 years ago. And that could be like way worse. Like in some of our biggest cities, the waiting list for public housing is not counted in years, it's counted in decades. So if you're a young parent in Washington, D.C., and you apply for public housing today, you're probably a grandparent by the time your application comes up for review. So if Arlene wanted public housing, this is what she'd have to do. She'd have to wait 2 or 3 years until the list unfroze, and then wait another 2 to 5 years until her application made it to the top of the pile, and then she'd just have to like pray that the person reviewing her application would ignore all the evictions she's collected while trying to make ends meet on the private market, unassisted, on a welfare check. So on 13th Street, Arlene found rollers and brushes and this 5-gallon bucket of paint, and she gave the walls a fresh coat. But not long after moving in, her sister died. It wasn't her biological sister, it was like her spiritual sister. They were close. And Arlene pitched in for the funeral. She didn't have the money, but no one else did either. And she felt it was her obligation to do something, and she would have been ashamed of herself if she didn't. The next month, she missed an appointment with her welfare caseworker because the letter announcing the appointment was mailed to Atkinson Avenue, or maybe it was 19th Street. And her caseworker typed something into the computer, and Arlene's $628 a month check was cut, sanctioned. So 2 months behind, she got the pink papers, the eviction summons and complaint. So Milwaukee is a city of about 105,000 renter households. And every year in Milwaukee, landlords evict about 16,000 1,000 people. That's 40 people a day evicted in the city of Milwaukee. If you look only in the inner city, you learn that 1 in 14 renter-occupied households is evicted through the court system every year, making eviction, frankly, commonplace, regular, normal in the poorest neighborhoods of the city. Milwaukee is no outlier here. The numbers are similar in Kansas City, Cleveland. I've looked at Chicago, looked at New York City that sees 60 Marshall evictions every day. This is a book about Milwaukee, but it tells a broader American story. We know from national data that renters in over 2.8 million homes reported that they thought that they'd be evicted soon. Now, the numbers on this screen, these are only court-ordered evictions. These are only formal evictions that go through the court. But there are other ways, cheaper and quicker ways, for a landlord to move a family out. So I met a landlord that would like pay you $200 and let you use his van if you're out by the end of the week. I met a landlord that if you're behind, he just takes your door off. We worked really hard in the survey to collect all those informal evictions that never see the inside of a court. And if you add those with the formal evictions that do go through the court, and if you also pay attention to landlord foreclosures, like when a landlord, the bank takes a landlord's home, and you look at building condemnations, like what happened to Arlene's favorite place, you learn that every 2 years in Milwaukee, 1 in 8 renters experience an eviction. Every 2 years, 1 in 8. This is an incredible, astoundingly high number. We've known for a long time that low-income families have high rates of stuff that policymakers like to call like residential instability or high rates of mobility. Folks have always commented on the frequency of moves among the poor without telling us why. I think what this research shows is like folks are moving so much because they're forced to. They have to. Eviction affects the young and the old, the sick and the able-bodied, but as many people in this room know, the face of America's eviction epidemic belongs to moms with kids. Walk into about any urban housing court in the country and you're just going to see moms and kids. In the South Bronx housing court, they used to have a daycare because there were so many kids in housing court. The majority of households in Milwaukee that are evicted have children living in them. And poor African American and Latino moms and women in generally are especially at high risk of eviction. Among Milwaukee renters, 1 in 5 black women, 1 in 5 reports being evicted sometime in her life, compared to 1 in 15 white women. If incarceration has come to define the lives of poor African American men, eviction is coming to define the lives of poor African American women. These black men, these poor African American men are being locked up, and poor African American women are being locked out. But the lack of affordable housing in our cities and the growing number of Americans paying 50, 60, 70% of their income to pay rent to keep the lights on, that's an issue that's affecting a lot of folks. It's affecting black communities and white communities, immigrant communities. It's affecting folks on the coast and folks in the middle of the country, too. Today, 1 in 5 of all renting families in the country, report paying at least 50% of their income on housing. So in eviction court, the court commissioner, as is court custom, gave Arlene 2 extra days in her place for each of her kids. And those days came and went, and Arlene had to be out on a day in early January. You guys know this, you live in the Midwest, early January is cold. And this Milwaukee winter was especially cold. The weathermen had been working themselves up. They said it was gonna be the coldest day in a decade. They said that temperature could bottom out at 40 below with the wind chill. There, like even on the news, there was like this thing where like it was frostbite time warnings were flashing on the screen. But if Arlene waited any longer, her landlord would call the sheriff, who days later would arrive with a sidearm and a team of movers and a judge's order, and they would have piled everything on the street, her mattresses, the meat cuts in the freezer, Jafaris's asthma machine, her copy of Don't Be Afraid to Discipline, her nice curtains. So they left, and Jory loaded this U-Haul moving truck that a friend of the family had rented for them, and it was just freezing. It was freezing. And the cold gripped him, and he put on an extra coat, and he smiled through it. He was happy to be useful and helping. Eileen didn't know where she and her boys would sleep that night. She tried the lodge and other shelters, but they were full as usual. She'd have to worry about that later. For now, she was focused on taking what she could to a storage unit that she had sold half of her food stamps and a space heater to rent. So Arlene finally found a room available in a shelter about 30 minutes away from Milwaukee, and she started calling on more apartments. And so she called on or applied to 20 apartments, and then 40, and then 60, and then 80. I counted. She had been accepted to none. And even in the inner city, many were out of reach. And the landlords of the places she could afford, if she threw almost everything she had at rent, weren't calling back. And part of the reason, besides her poverty, had to do with her eviction record. And in Milwaukee and in many other cities across the nation, thanks to open record laws, your record is easily accessible and free online. It's just like a website, like any other website. And many landlords that I met reject anyone with a recent eviction, like an eviction within 2 or 3 years. And that's a big reason why folks like Arlene, after their eviction, move into worse neighborhoods and worse housing. There was another reason why landlords weren't accepting Arlene and her kids. One landlord wanted $8.25 a month, plus an additional $25 for jewelry. Arlene let herself laugh at that. Another flat out said, we don't want your kids, ma'am. Children cooped up in small apartments use curtains for superhero capes, and they flush toys down the toilet, and they cause a man whose car has just been whacked with a snowball to kick your door in. They can attract the attention of the police. They can test positive for lead poisoning, which could cause a pricey abatement order. In the words of one landlord that I met, children cause us headache. Housing discrimination against kids, families, is illegal. We're at a law school. It's illegal. But it often is not recognized as discrimination, and audit studies have found that families face discrimination in the housing search in as many as 7 out of 10 searches. Arlene didn't have time to think about that. She just dialed another number. So finally, like Mr. 90, the 90th landlord, said yes. He had a one-bedroom apartment. It was $525. Arlene didn't much consider the conditions of the place or the kind of neighborhood. A house is a house, she told Jory. So 2 months after her eviction court hearing, she moved into her new place, and she really liked it. Like, all the cupboards had handles, all the lights had fixtures, and after her and her boys had unloaded everything into the place, Arlene sat down on the floor, and she found, like, a garbage bag with towels in it, and she leaned against it, and Jory came and sat next to his mom and pitched his head into her shoulder, and Jafaris laid his little 6-year-old head on her lap, and they just stayed like that for a long time. So Arlene got her stuff out of storage. She hung pictures on the wall. She liked things neat, so over the sink, she wrote a little note to Jory that said, if you don't clean up after yourself, we're gonna have problems. But shortly after they moved in, Jory began acting out at his new school. It's tough to be 14. It's tough to be 14 and homeless. Between 7th and 8th grade, Jory went to 5 different schools. And one day, a teacher yelled at him, and he kicked her in the shin and ran home. And instead of calling the principal, the teacher called the police. And after officers paid Arlene a visit, her landlord told her she had to leave. It's like kids, right? Kids, man. I mean, they can prolong the time you're homeless after eviction, and they sometimes are the reason for your eviction. So when I analyze survey data of all these folks that went to eviction court so I can understand why do you get evicted and you don't, even though you both go to eviction court, the big thing that we found is you have kids. And you can hold constant how much you owe a landlord, your household income, things like race and gender, all these things that we think are going to be important to predicting who gets evicted. And what really matters is, do kids live in your household? If they do, that triples your odds of receiving an eviction judgment in Milwaukee court. And you're not seeing a judge make that decision or a landlord. What you're seeing in that finding is, or excuse me, not a commissioner, but what you're seeing in that finding is a landlord saying, I'll work with you, I'd rather not work with you. So Arlene was beginning to unravel. It's like I got a curse on me, she told me. It won't stop for nothing. Sometimes I find my body trembling, shaking, I'm tired, but I can't sleep. I'm fixing to have a nervous breakdown. My body is trying to shut down. Recently published a study that showed that mothers who are evicted experience higher rates of depressive symptoms 2 years after their eviction. And we know that suicides attributed to evictions and foreclosures doubled between 2005 and 2010, years where housing costs, especially in the rental market, were soaring across the country. Every sheriff deputy that I've met that does eviction moves has a suicide story. Jory felt bad that kicking the teacher caused his family to be evicted again, and they stayed for a while in a living room with Fran, and they stayed a while with Arlene's sister, and Arlene found another rundown apartment on another dangerous block, and it wasn't long before her and her kids were robbed at gunpoint in that apartment, causing them to flee once more to another shelter. "Just my soul is messed up," she told me after that happened. "I wish my life were different. I wish that when I be an old lady, I can sit back and look at my kids and they be grown. And they, you know, become something. And we'll all be together and be laughing, remembering stuff like this, and be laughing at it." The home is the center of life. It's our refuge from work. It's our shield from the menace of the streets. It's our wellspring of personhood. We say at home, we're ourselves. Everywhere else, we're somebody else. But at home, we remove our mask. It's where, as kids, we play. As we're adolescents, we retreat and try. And as adults, we settle down. We try to raise a family, invest in our work. In languages spoken all over the world, the word for home encompasses not just shelter, but warmth, safety, family, the womb. Eviction causes loss. Families not only lose their homes, but their schools, their neighborhoods, their possessions, furniture, clothes, books. Eagle Movers told me that 70% of the eviction or foreclosures moves that they do that goes into their storage unit just gets thrown in the dump. It takes a good amount of time and money to establish a home. Eviction can erase all that. Eviction comes with a court record, which can bar you from decent housing and safe neighborhoods, but it also can prevent you from receiving government aid because housing authorities treat eviction records as strikes against your application, which means we are systematically denying assistance to the people most need of it. Eviction could cause workers to lose their jobs, and anyone in this room who's experienced an eviction knows exactly why. It's this consuming, stressful, often drawn-out event that can cause you to make mistakes on your work, call in sick, and eventually lose your footing in the labor market. And then there's the toll eviction takes on your spirit, your mental health. And when you add all this up, I think we have to conclude that evictions, which used to be rare, which used to draw crowds, that eviction is not just a condition of poverty, but a cause of it. And it's leaving a deep and jagged scar on the next generation. Housing plays a huge role in creating poverty in America today, and we can't fix poverty without fixing housing. So how do we fix it? So, you know, imagine if every family in the US had a decent, affordable place to live. If Arlene didn't have to dedicate 88% of her income to rent, she could keep her kids fed and clothed and off the streets. When families finally receive a housing voucher after years and years and years on the waiting list, they do one consistent thing with the freed up income. They buy more food. They buy more food. And their kids become stronger and less anemic and healthier. But the majority of poor families aren't so lucky, and their kids with names like Jory and Jafaris are not getting enough to eat because the rent eats first. What we need is a housing program for the unlucky majority, the millions of poor families unassisted in the private market. And if we cannot afford the freedoms that this country offers us without a roof over our head, basically the freedom to better ourselves, to invest in our kids, to improve our communities, then shouldn't the right to a decent home be part of what it means to be an American? We've affirmed provision in old age, 12 years of education, basic nutrition, to be the right of every citizen in this country because we have recognized that human dignity and flourishing and economic mobility depends on those things. And it is impossible to argue that housing is not central to human flourishing and mobility. I think decent, affordable housing should absolutely be a basic right for everyone in this country. And the reason is really simple. Without stable shelter, everything else falls apart. So how can we deliver on that obligation? I think the good news is much has already been accomplished. And I know when we have talks like this, it can leave us in feeling some sort of way, you know? But the good news, especially with housing, is that we've made giant leaps forward in a progressive way. You know, and just think in generations past, this is Chicago, actually, in 1941. In generations past, there were slums ravaging our cities, and poor folks had to wear their winter coats inside all year round because they were living with no heat and no water inside. There are outhouses in the middle of Philadelphia, like not too long ago. We as a nation took on a battle with the slum, and we totally won. And I will be the first to admit, we still have a long way to go on this. When I lived in the trailer park in Milwaukee, for most of the time I lived in there, I had no hot water. And I told my landlord, like, I'm a writer writing about you in your trailer park. So imagine what my neighbors had to deal with. But like, there's no arguing, like, we made giant leaps forward in terms of housing quality in this country. And I also take heart in the work of so many of you and so many folks out there, these amazing community organizations, these nonprofit warriors that are working hard to decrease family homelessness, to prevent eviction, and preserve affordable housing. So one thing I've done around the launch of this book is create a website called Just Shelter. And it's actually a page in the book that you can go to. And if you want to learn how to get involved in your community or plug in with your time or your resources, you can go to this map and you can search over 600 nonprofit organizations from every single state and find out who's working hard on this thing. And if you guys are an organization and you don't see yourself on this, there's a little link for you and we'll get you on the map. So the bigger story, right, is like a problem as big as the affordable housing crisis calls for a big solution. And I think that solution, one that would make the dream of a right to housing a reality, is a universal voucher program, housing voucher program. Got some dissenters over here. The idea is really simple. We can take this program that we have that's already working pretty well, and we expand it to everyone below the poverty line. That way, if you are Arlene and you get a voucher, you don't pay 80% of your income to rent, 70% of your income to rent, you pay 30% of your income to rent, with the voucher covering the rest. You can take that voucher and you can live anywhere you want as long as your housing isn't too expensive or too shabby. Universal housing programs have been successfully implemented all over the world, like Great Britain and the Netherlands. And here, a universal housing program would fundamentally change the face of poverty. Evictions would plummet. They could become rare again. Homelessness would plummet. Families would immediately feel the income gains and be able to buy enough food and invest in themselves and their children through schooling or job training, start a modest savings. They would find stability and have a sense of ownership over their home and their community. Would a universal housing program disincentivize work? It's a fair question. One study has shown that housing assistance does lead to a modest reduction in work hours. A lot of other studies have found no effect. And I think that in truth, the status quo is much more of a threat to self-sufficiency than any housing program could be. Families crushed by the high cost of housing, they can't afford vocational training or extra schooling that would allow them to acquire new skills. And many can't stay in one place long enough to just hold down a job. And think of all that talent and energy and brain power that just like squandered because families have to dedicate so much focus and so much time trying to make rent or trying to find housing after they're evicted. A national affordable housing program would be an anti-poverty effort, a human capital investment, a community improvement plan, and a public health initiative all rolled into one. Poverty reduces people born for better things. Look, the poor don't want some small life. They don't want to game the system or eke out an existence. They want to thrive and contribute. They want to become nurses or run their own charities. That's what Arlene's dream was. And a stable home will extend them the opportunity to realize those dreams. Can we afford it? So some economists have argued that the current housing voucher program could be expanded to all poor families in America without additional spending if we just made that program more efficient. Even if we did nothing, we still could afford to offer this crucial benefit to all low-income families. The Bipartisan Policy Center estimated that it would cost about an additional $22 billion every year. That's a figure that does not account for the savings in terms of like reducing homelessness, reducing the mental health effects of eviction, and all the things we already pay for because we tolerate high amounts of eviction in our cities. Now, $22 billion is not a small figure, but it's well within our capacity. We have the money. We've just made choices about how to spend it. So today, housing-related tax expenditures, like the mortgage income tax reduction, far outpace housing assistance for renters. We have a universal housing program in this country. It's just not for poor people. The year Arlene was evicted from 13th Street, federal expenditures for direct housing assistance to the needy totaled about $41 billion. That same year, homeowner tax benefits exceeded $171 billion. That figure, $171 billion, that was equivalent to the 2008 budgets for the Department of Education, Veteran Affairs, Homeland Security, Justice, and Agriculture combined. It's a large number. Most federal housing subsidies benefit families with six-figure incomes. Fact. So if we're going to spend like the bulk of our public money on the affluent, at least when it comes to housing, let's just like own up. Let's just be honest about that. Let's just own up to that fact and stop repeating the canard that this rich country can't afford to do more. If poverty persists in this land, it's not for our lack of resources. We lack something else. A universal housing program is one policy recommendation. Let others come. Establishing a basic right to housing in America could be realized by any number of ways and probably should be. What works in New York might fail in Chicago. What LA needs, Milwaukee doesn't. One city has to tear down, another one has to build. Our cities are rich in diversity. They have different problems and different gifts, and maybe our policy should be too. But I think that whatever our way out of this mess, one thing is certain, like this degree of inequality, this cold denial of basic rights, this blunting of human capacity, this level of social suffering, like this isn't us. This doesn't have to be us. By no American value is this situation justified. There is no moral code, no ethical principle, there is no piece of scripture or holy teaching that can be summoned to defend what we've allowed our country to become.
Thank you so much, Mr. Desmond. And again, thanks to Fan for bringing him here and for MacArthur for supporting his work. We have Jim over on this side who's gonna have a microphone for folks who have questions, and Danielle over here. So raise your hand and they'll come to you with the microphone.
Hi, thank you so much for joining us. I really enjoyed this talk. I actually don't really work in housing, although I work at the Shriver Center and we have lots of wonderful housing folks. But I'm really sort of curious if you could sort of expand a little bit more, or if you know of any data or stats on sort of your mention that eviction is to Black women as incarceration is to Black men. And sort of I'm sure that there's a really strong correlation there as to the fathers of these kids are probably locked up in our prisons, and just wondering if there's a little bit more there that is available for somebody to dive into who might be interested in that. Thank you.
So we know that like a criminal record is tough, right? We know that it hurts you on the job market. We know that prevents you from becoming a full citizen. Can you not hear me? Someone say something? Okay, sorry about that. So we know that criminal records do things to people after they've done their time. The eviction record operates in the same way. There's a parallelism there. We have kind of a effect in the labor market for a criminal record, also in the housing market. We have an effect in the housing market, especially for an eviction record. An eviction record also can affect your credit and other things like that, you know, especially if landlords report to credit reporting agencies. And so like there's over 600 companies today that are doing this. They're collecting eviction records and kind of broadcasting them and selling them to landlords. And so there's a direct parallelism there. There's a direct parallelism too in like our federal spending and also state spending. So in some states, like literally they directed money away from public housing into prisons. And I think now that we're having a public conversation, like we have a lot of public housing, right? It's like prison. And so like I think now that we're having a conversation about how to decarcerate and how to lower our incarceration numbers, I think we need as a housing community to say, hey, can we have those funds back? Like can you get us back for like 30 years ago when you did that thing? We really need it. And so I think there's a direct parallelism there. And then I think just like incarceration has become this like typical thing in the life course for young, low-income African-American men. That's the eviction story, too. So I remember Patrice Hingston is this woman I write about in the book. When she was experiencing her first eviction, I was kind of like, don't you think this is a big deal? And she's like, no, everyone I know except my white friends have an eviction record. That's super troubling. That's super troubling. And I remember an eviction where that happened to Arlene, and like no one, we didn't know that the movers are coming, and they were there just like tossing up the house. And Jafaris comes home from school and he walks up and he does nothing. He doesn't run to get a new toy. He doesn't like cry. He just like takes it in, turns around and goes outside to play. That's troubling. And so I think that there is this deep parallelism in terms of prevalence and consequence of these two things working together. And the larger story about why is a policy story about how these two institutions are connected. Hey, Becca.
Hi.
Did I rep Milwaukee okay?
Yes, okay. Sorry. I reviewed his book for a magazine that I work for. So I've already read it. And one of the things that struck me, you know, you illuminate these stories of these people, and the details that are in it are what is so heartbreaking and mind-wrecking. And one of the things that I can't stop questioning is, how are these landlords allowed to have these buildings in such terrible disrepair, not fit for humans to live in? Why is there nothing, why do you think that there's nothing being done? I mean, you're talking about, if you look at Milwaukee, it's really not a large area, this whole inner city, north side, et cetera. You know, someone could look at that, and I don't understand why city resources aren't put into making those landlords fix those homes, making those homes fit to live in before they're able to be rented. Like, why is nobody paying enough attention to that, and why are resources not spent legally and otherwise on fixing that?
I think one answer is that if we don't fix the affordable housing crisis, we can't fix this problem. And so we're at a law school, and I think if we looked at the laws on the books in Milwaukee in terms of like protections for people, we'd say these are all right. Like these are totally fair and legit and good. And so, you know, if your landlord doesn't provide heat or plumbing, you don't even have to put your rent into escrow in Milwaukee. You can like literally keep it until the landlord fixes things. Building inspectors, if you call them, they have to come and inspect your place, and they can issue code violations to landlords. They can, you know, they have real power. The problem is, if you're someone like Arlene, right, and you're paying 88% of your income to rent, like you're going to have to ask a favor of your landlord one of these days. And so in someone like Arlene, when she moves into some place and a landlord says you need first month's rent, last month's rent, security deposit, that's impossible. And so landlords usually say, well, come on anyways, and you can work it off. And so tenants start off behind, and that's a part of a business model. And that business model allows people like Arlene to get a home, and allows landlords like Arlene's landlord, Sharina, to kind of skimp on maintenance, because she knows that if Arlene calls a building inspector, she could evict her, not because retaliatory evictions are legal, but because you can evict someone at any time for non-payment of rent. So there's several scenes in the book, as you know, where tenants are like, should I report that we haven't had plumbing in 2 weeks? But if we do, like, I think we're going to get evicted. And so I think the important implication for those of us who care about changing things through the law is that there's law on paper and there's law in practice. And if we have a situation where most poor families are in a situation of extreme rent burden, beefing up the laws might not do as much as we think they will.
So I'm an attorney, and there's a few attorneys here. I'm curious about how good we are at listening to our clients and understanding these practical problems of they face in our advocacy, and if you have kind of seen attorneys being more effective or less effective in representing their clients by understanding their context.
Yeah.
And I also am wondering, like, when I'm hearing Arlene's story, I'm thinking, gosh, I wish I had represented her, or that she, yeah, I could have found her and stopped one of those. So what could attorneys do to be more accessible, or is that just a larger problem of, it is a problem of lack of resources, but
yeah,
what can we do to be more accessible to these clients?
I think you can, like, clone yourself. I wish we were at a place, right, where we had to be like, how can we listen to our clients better? Like, we're just at a place like, can we just get more people in housing court? So as many of you know better than I do, Folks in eviction court have no right to a lawyer. And so in many housing courts around the country, 90% of landlords have lawyers and 90% of tenants don't. And like Arlene had 11th grade education, she's summoned to eviction court, she has to face her landlord's lawyer. Like, would you even go? So most folks in Milwaukee don't. Milwaukee has a 70% default rate. And so the book makes a hard case for like the right to counsel in civil court. And we know from randomized control studies that lawyers make a huge difference, like even regardless of the merits of the case. And so you guys would do things like stop illegal evictions and make sure folks that are pregnant don't get evicted because of that, and curb bad stipulations and make sure people's cases are heard, unlike the vast majority today. I feel like we need to get there, and then like we could pick, you know. So I'm kind of like, gosh, I don't even know the answer to this amazing question. I just know like, gosh, we're like meeting 10% of the need, right? And there's this 90% of folks that just need folks by their side. So,
Matt, did you want to talk about your reference to his book in your work?
I guess I just know that we have cited your study a little bit since it came out, because once in a while the effect of an eviction should come in as a legal factor in some of the cases that we're facing. So it actually has been helpful to us to be able to cite empirical evidence about the consequences of eviction in some of our cases. So we appreciate you being here and the work
that's
you're
cool.
doing.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, thank you. That was a really interesting talk and I learned a lot. Something I'm still kind of puzzling over is how you're thinking about your policy solution of having vouchers, and I totally buy the notion of housing being a human right, but I was curious if you could say more about how you think about trade-offs between having vouchers as that solution as opposed to, say, like public housing as that solution.
Yeah, I think that the history of public housing is a history of like us massively defunding a program, and public housing that didn't fail because there is something inherently wrong with it, even in this city, which is kind of the poster city for the failure of public housing. It failed just because we like stopped paying the bills. And I think that's just an important thing to say when we kind of compare these two things. In some cities, public housing is the most efficient way to offer housing, especially in high-cost, tight-market cities. So 1 out of 4 public housing units in the country is in New York City. It makes a lot of sense to do public housing in that city. But there's no study that exists in the universe that shows us that you can offer housing of equal quality for lesser costs by building it. So vouchers are just a much more efficient way of doing it. They have much more broader bipartisan support. It's gonna cost a lot less money to do it like that. And it's gonna allow families a certain degree of freedom that allows us not to repeat the sins of our past when it comes to public housing and shoring up and concentrating poverty. And like we have to do something on, like I always come back to scale. It's the problem of scale. And in every city you go to, we were talking about this at lunch, there's like these amazing things going on. You know, like Portland's building these amazing green public housing units and Baltimore's clearing out blight for their vacant, like all this cool stuff going on, but it's like we're bleeding out, right? We're just bleeding out. And I think that if we want to address this thing at scale in an efficient way, in an expedient way, vouchers are clearly the best way to go.
Following on the question on policy, you've been doing your book tour around the country. I love your policy recommendations. Has anybody taken up the banner and said, yes, we'll do it, like the National Low-Income Housing Coalition or National Fair Housing Alliance? Who's, like, is somebody ready to say, all right, let's do it. Let's work on implementing these policies.
Yeah, yeah. So the book just came out like 11 days ago. So we're working on it. But I've been really encouraged about the public conversation we're having. And I've been really encouraged that people are responding to the parts of the book that I want them to respond to. You know, and we've been in contact with, a lot of folks in Washington have reached out. A lot of community organizations have reached out. And we're starting these conversations and trying to think of how to build coalitions along these things. One of the coolest things about these book talks is like, there's all these people in the housing world that often never like come and hang out, that are like in the same room, and I hope you guys like trade business cards and hang out and go get a beer afterwards or something. And I, because I think we are going to have
30. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's 5 o'clock somewhere.
Oh, 5 o'clock.
And it's a rough talk, you know. And so like I think we're building towards something, and I think that's really encouraging. The other day, like the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel wrote this editorial that like they were like, yes, housing is a right. Like a major paper of a major American city, like. like came down and endured, which is incredible to me. And so I think like we're starting a conversation, and it's up to kind of us to keep pushing it. Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate the book and the presentation. And I certainly, as someone who's worked in the housing area for 35 years, I certainly agree about your primary policy prescription. I would disagree, however, that we as an American people are fundamentally good and charitable and righteous. I think we do ourselves a great disservice by continuing this "we're number one" fallacy that we have about ourselves, because it keeps us from dealing with the severity of the issue. The only thing that I would ask about is that your prescription doesn't deal with the underlying problem. The phrase, housing as a human right, the backside of that phrase is not a commodity. And until we start reducing the emphasis of the profit motive, we won't ultimately get a handle on this. Rent subsidies continue to feed the profit motive and in fact drive market rents. I think we need a combination of tools such as rent control, proscriptive, preactive building inspections, so tenants aren't always in the position of ratting out their landlords and suffering the consequences with that, just cause for eviction. There's a whole list of tools, and any one geographic area needs a series of these tools, not just one. I would finally refer people to the work of the Right to the City Alliance, who from the ground up tenant movement nationwide is taking some of your prescriptions and some of these other things quite seriously and are leading the things in Portland, Seattle, Boston. Unfortunately, we here in Chicago, tremendous amount of pride as I have in Chicago, but we're behind the curve.
Yeah, so I feel like we need to have a conversation where there's a lot of different things on the table. I think that, the book, I feel like the book addresses this question. And it kind of argues at the end that, you know, poverty is not just a product of low incomes, it's also a product of exploitation. And we do have to be honest about the fact that there's some people that are making a lot of money by pulling out money from the pockets of the poor. So one thing that I did in this book was really try to figure out like how much are landlords making? And here's one example of that. So Tobin was my landlord at the trailer park. At the time that I lived in it, the city literally classified it as an environmental biohazard because it had so many code violations. So I copied Tobin's books, like his own rent rolls, so I could pay attention to things like vacancies, missed payments, like a third of the trailer park was behind every month. I pulled his mortgage records and his water bill and his electric bill from public records. I paid attention to his eviction expenses and his advertising fees and his overhead. And I'm going on and on about this, so you like believe me. So when I tell you that the owner of probably the worst trailer park in Milwaukee, which was 131 trailers, took home about $470,000 every year after expenses. That's like 30 times what his tenants working minimum wage full time took home, and 50 times what his tenants like Lorraine, who are on disability, took home. You know, are we okay with that? And so I think that you're right that we need to start a conversation about that aspect of poverty as well.
Matthew, I really was impressed with your talk. I regret that I have not read the book yet, but
just 11 days ago. It's like, don't feel bad.
I would like to ask whether community organizing has been at all effective in working with these folks. I mean, I can see difficulties because they're on the move a lot, also because they don't have much time and probably are pretty hopeless, but I'm wondering if any successful efforts have been done in that direction.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think there's a way of answering that as a scholar and then a way of answering it as a public observer. As a scholar, I think that you look back historically and you have to answer yes. You know, there's been massive massive change that's happened because of community organizing when tenants saw themselves as a class of people with shared interests and a purpose. And so tenant organizing and rent strikes, for example, convinced a very conservative state legislature in New York to impose rent control on America's largest city. That was done through normal families striking and organizing together. And I think that we see example after example of that historically. Tenants had their political organization and landlords had theirs and organized to kind of get rent control off the docket. I think that's the scholarly take. Is it just a public observer? It seems like there's something, I feel like there's something happening where the cost of housing has got to a point where people are beginning to talk about a nation of renters, a coalition. And we do see, especially in cities like San Francisco or Seattle, New York, very strong organization happening on behalf of the tenants and through the tenants. So I gave a talk in New York City a few days ago, and it was like NYU and CASA. And CASA is like this community organization in the South Bronx that are really pushing for a right to house, right to counsel in New York. And they're like this close to getting it. It's really close. And so I feel like that's one step, and the right to city is another one, of folks really doing things on a community level in a very smart and effective way. Yeah.
I did just want to comment that I started talking, we do have MTO here, which is great, but I started reaching out to some community organizers about coming today, and it was like blasphemy because it's election day, and they're out working on the election, and they were like, what? No, we have other work that we have to do. So we would have had more community organizers, but for
Hi, so I'm just kind of curious. My perception is that mass incarceration is a really, really big issue in our country, and it's kind of been a focus of the election a little bit. Do you think that evictions are equally an issue? And also, why do you think that they are not, why have I not heard about this until today?
Yeah, don't feel bad. Don't feel bad about that. So a lot of us hadn't. I hadn't. Like, when I started this research, I thought evictions would be like I'm a kind of a writer, like a narrative frame, like a way for me to tell a story about poverty housing. Like, I had no idea, like a city like Milwaukee seeing like 40 people tossed every single day, you know? I had no idea that like we are evicting people, not in the tens or the hundreds of thousands, but in the millions around the country. And I had no idea that it'd be so consequential across a lot of different domains, like where you live, your kind of housing, your mental health. We just didn't know this stuff. And so like, I think that the contribution of this work is to put eviction on the map. And I think that mass incarceration is fundamentally important to inequality today. And so are things like fair wages and unemployment. And so is things like the family and public policy. You know, there's a lot in education. There's a lot of stuff that's going on. But I think that like housing has to be at the top of the domestic agenda. And I think that policymakers on both sides of the aisle are having a conversation today about poverty and inequality. But when they talk, they mostly talk about jobs and what to do about jobs. Either you incentivize work, if you're Paul Ryan, if you're Hillary Clinton, you want to raise minimum wage. But I think that's only part of the solution. And I think that if we don't think about poverty from the top up and the bottom down, so to speak, this two-pronged approach, our efforts are going to be diluted. I would never say that housing is more or less important than incarceration. I would never say it's more or less important than jobs. It's hard to tell someone that just got out of prison, you know, like housing is a much bigger issue than what you just went through. I would never say that, but I would also never, you know, but you think of someone like Arlene, housing is centrally important. That's her central issue to her life. I think that we obviously as a country have to think about doing something better in terms of mass incarceration. And housing is a big part of that too. I mean, over 700,000 folks are released from prison every single year, and housing is a big issue for them. So these things kind of cluster and go together. But I think that like affordable, stable housing is like a really great foothold into stability and economic mobility and just like community health.
So yeah, I moved not to the front, but to the side. I have a question, if it's not too personal, to ask about your own process of being a presence in the community with privilege.
Yeah.
And you know, I was describing to people where I was coming today and who you were, and I said, isn't that interesting? Like, what would the folks you lived with think about, you know, sort of where you are now, right? That you've got this platform and you won this wonderful award. I guess if you don't mind sharing, I've done some research as well, and I'm still plagued with this sense of guilt in some way that I profited from other people's suffering. Yeah. They shared their stories with me, and I feel still compelled to continue to tell their stories, but I don't at all feel like I gave back enough or as much as I got from that community.
That you wrote about feel that way, though? So I've gotten this question, and I've lost sleep over this question, obviously. One thing that helps is we've started something called the Evicted Book Foundation, which takes proceeds from the book and directly benefits the families in the book. And there's a board and there's a process, and if you guys want to help the families, like go to justshelter.org, you can find out how to do that. So we're doing that with the families, which is really cool. So we are directly helping them in a direct way because of this. I think they feel like that's less important, though, than like their stories getting out there. And so Arlene and I have had a lot of conversations about why people care about her story. Like, she doesn't understand why people care about her story. And she came to the book launch event with me in Milwaukee, and there were like 300 people there, and there were folks asking about her, how are her kids doing and stuff, and I think it was special for her to take that in and to see, like, to tell her story as a broader, to understand her eviction is a broader story of something that's not just on her, you know. And so when we first went over the book, she was like, you know, I see a lot of mistakes in here, but I also see a lot of strength. And what she meant by mistakes is like her mistakes. And I think that I've always been like, look, like, I make mistakes all the time. Like, you missed an appointment. I miss appointments all the time. I don't get evicted for it. And I think that it's a process of trying to provide an alternative story for her story and to show her and other folks in the book like what her story is doing. And I think that's really meaningful for her. So when I was in college, like, my parents, we got foreclosed. I lost my childhood home. And I remember experiencing that like with just like shame, and like I was just embarrassed. And that's how a lot of folks like Arlene experience eviction too. And I think one thing that I think that this opportunity allows is to retell that story. And then, like, so it's been wonderful to have folks in the book at the events, like, alongside me. And I think one of our next steps is to take them to DC and to have conversations and put them in front of policymakers and see what they say when they, you know, when Arlene or Vanetta and other people in the book share their story. So, yeah.
All right, I think we have time for one more question. We have to sell some books. And I know Matt had other questions, and maybe some folks who came here from the housing community. Did you want to make an announcement? Okay, John, so you get to have the last question. And then if folks want to stay and talk in here while he's signing books, who work in housing issues or are just interested in, feel free to stay.
I know you didn't really talk about gentrification at all, but I'm really thinking that in many ways evictions are really tied also to the whole wealthy taking back the center of the cities and all that and pushing kind of poorer people out to the edges and all that. And I wonder, so I guess I wondered, do you see like the same things happening in Europe where that's already in existence, where the poor live on the outskirts? Yeah. And or is this like part of just the whole gentrification where we're forcing people out? And then, you know, then I ask, will like your solution isn't really going to help that aspect of what's going on, is this like dislocation, displacement of people?
Yeah, I think you're right to point out that this just isn't just an American problem. So the average home in London takes 30 years of the average British salary. rents in Delhi are the same as Midtown Manhattan. In Lagos, which is a which has like 21 million people now, over 60% of folks in that city are spending over half of their income on housing. Most folks live in one-room dwellings. So this is a problem that's affecting a lot of cities around the globe. We've cut global poverty in half in the last 50 years, but we've done that by moving the world to cities, and cities are becoming unaffordable to not just millions, but billions of people around the globe. I think we have to address that. I'd like to so I feel like there's an easy way to answer your question, but I don't want to let myself off the hook, and I want to encourage us not to let ourselves off the hook, and there's a lot of, I don't know if we really know why cities are becoming so expensive. I don't know if we know that. You know, and so, and I think that I could say an economic model, or I could talk about gentrification, but every city I've looked at, most evictions aren't happening in gentrifying neighborhoods. They're happening in poor, ungentrifying neighborhoods, which is becoming unaffordable to everyone. I have to look at a lot more data before I kind of believe stuff about global capital flux is increasing the price of our cities, or it's about the return to the city and that's driving up costs. I think we need to have a lot more catch in our voice about that. One of the weirdest things we discovered in Milwaukee was the price of rent that separates rent in the most expensive areas of the city and rent in the least expensive areas. Just to nerd out with you in just a second, 90th percentile of the distribution, 10th percentile of the distribution, that amount is $270. That's crazy. That means rent in some of the worst neighborhoods in the city is basically the same as rent in the average neighborhood of the city. Why? What's going on? I don't know. So I think we need a lot more, we need a lot more eyes on that. And we need to be not complacent about what's going on and what the story is. I do think gentrification on a city level is unarguably a huge problem. And what I mean by that is you take a city like Boston. Boston has one revenue source, it's property taxes. You can only raise property taxes if you get the state legislature to approve it, so that's not gonna happen. Half of Boston is exempt because it's hospitals and universities. So you can be Bernie Sanders, but if you're the mayor of Boston, you gotta fund your city. What are you gonna do? You're gonna gentrify your city. And so I think that there's these larger political constraints that we also have to think about when it comes to the gentrification too.
Okay, thank you. I know that there's lots more questions, and maybe you can catch Matt out when you're buying his book. Please do complete this and put it out front for us. This helps us bring folks like Mr. Desmond here. Let's give him a round of applause.